So thank you for attending my talk. Very pleased to be here to talk about the work I'm doing for the ISAE Research Fund. So I would like to introduce this plenary session with a video so you really understand what is perseveration exactly.
We have until 1,000 feet, approximately 1,700.
1,700.
1,000 feet, roger, roger.
You're turning slowly to the right, correct?
No, we're keeping course to fly away from the shore.
No, we're trying to maintain course.
So you want course 4 proceed to localizer, right?
Correct.
No, not yet. Let's
turn
solve the
right,
problem.
Heading 350, we suggest.
Yeah, but we're
take
gonna...
the autopilot out?
The autopilots are out.
No, autopilots are on.
They're not set on. We go to 119.7.
Auto throttle is disconnected.
Auto throttle is disconnected.
Let's see what reads here.
Read all that.
Auto flight. Altitude alert, autopilot disconnect, rudder ratio. Okay.
Hey, shit, we're going down. Hey, shit.
Any airplane that could guide us in Aero Peru that may be around or somebody?
Don't tell them anything about that.
Yes, because right now we're stalling.
We're not stalling. It's fictitious. It's fictitious.
We have Shaker. How would it be not?
Shaker, but it is a... But even with speed brakes, we're maintaining 950 feet. Why don't we read the same? I don't understand. Power. What power do we have?
Look, it's coming back. My speed's coming back.
No, it's gone to off.
It's gone to off.
Arrow through 603, you have turned slightly to the left. Now you're heading 320, and your level is 10,000 feet and a distance of 32 miles northwest of Lima.
Autopilot! Don't put any autopilot, Captain! Alt alert, autopilot disconnect.
Let's go to...
Autopilot disconnect 0603.
Ask him to tell us...
Autopilot disconnect. Alt alert, cabin and operative, rudder ratio. There's nothing new, but the overspeed...
Quick
flight
heading 070.
Auto flight. Auto flight. Altitude alert, autopilot disconnect, rudder ratio okay.
Hey, shit! We're going down.
Oh, shit.
How can it be flying at this speed if we are going down with all the power cut off?
Can you tell me that you have us on the radar at 50 miles?
Hey, look, the 370, we have...
What? 370 of what? Do we lower the...
What do we do with the gear?
Don't know that.
We're impacting water!
So this is the exact transcription of the flight data recording, voice data recording. This is Aero Peru accident that occurred like 25 or 30 years ago. It was a very simple failure, not that complex, but it leads to sum up all the pilot's resources and lead to a crisis in the management, poor decision-making, perseveration, and then to the crash. So this is what I'm going to try to talk today is I don't have the answer, but I'm thinking about potential explanation and would like to talk, to discuss with you about these potential solutions. So we'll talk about perseveration, lack of mental flexibility. I'm not going to talk about attentional impairment because we already talk a lot about inattentional deafness, so I guess you're a bit fed up with this concept. But I was lucky enough to get a 20-year chair funded by the AXA Research Fund. You should also, I strongly encourage you to apply to this fund because it can give you, a good way to conduct your research. So the topic is to understand the underlying neural mechanisms of perseveration, to implement real-time solution like brain-computer interface, and to design a solution to mitigate human error. Yeah, so as you saw in the previous movie, there's a series of accidents that are not only in aeronautics, because you can find that in the medical domain, ship operation, with treasure, at any level, where human operators like pilots are confused and overwhelmed, they fail to diagnose the situations, and they persist in erroneous courses of action, despite auditory alarms. What you have to keep in mind in this kind of accidents in the aeronautical domain is that the plane has not a critical failure. The situation is recoverable, but the stress leads the human operator to persist. So there's a need for a neuroergonomics approach. So many concepts have been put forward in human factors. Of course, plane continuation error. You probably heard about what we call the fixation error, a very famous work conducted by Dehais. So there are three types. So type one is the human operator unable to make up their mind to achieve the current goal. This is more or less what happened in the movie. In the beginning, then the human operator keep on doing the same erroneous sequence of action without any apparent control. Like in the movie, they tried several times to engage the autopilot, but this was meaningless. But You don't need to be in an airplane. It happened to me a long time ago with the kids yelling in the car. I had to dial the PIN code. I was repeating the same erroneous PIN code. Then I got locked and the kids were really upset after me. So due to fatigue or stress, you can have a loss of apparent control. And type three, the operators have overconfidence in their strategy and they neglect any auditory alarms. This is interesting, but only descriptive. You don't have access to the brain. There are other works very interesting from the psychosociology approach called the goal-driven approach. And according to these theories, cognition, focus only on goal achievements. So it seems that you guys are following like 15 or 20 goals during the day, okay, high-level goals. So to avoid interferences between these goals, there are mechanisms are implemented in the brain to shield against distraction. Okay, so this led Atkinson Cartwright a long time ago to postulate the goal inertia theory that echoes with the Newtonian theories, like a goal-directed tendency once aroused persists until satisfied or dissipated. I don't know if you've heard about the Zeigarnik effect. Wonderful work did by Zeigarnik. So he did a nice experiment. And participants were supposed to fulfill some different goals, but some of these goals were interrupted. Okay? Then after the end of the experiment, you were supposed as a participant to recall all the different goals you've been involved. And participants tend to recall only the interrupted goals. Thereafter, the participant had to start a new experiment, and then the opportunity either to start new goals or to fulfill the previous goal, an achieved goal, and all the participants wanted to achieve the unfulfilled goals. So this led Fox and Hoffman to state this beautiful sentence, perseveration is the rule, not the exception. So why perseveration is interesting? Because I think it rings a bell for neuropsychologists and MDs. So perseveration is a term that was first coined by Neisser like a century ago for a patient with a brain lesion. And the definition is the inappropriate repetition or continuation of an aerial response after a change in task requirements. So it looks exactly that what we observe in a movie with our pilots that's unable to adapt to the situation. And there is a test called Wisconsin card sorting test that assess mental flexibility. So you need to find the rules, then there's a new rule, you need to adapt to the new rules. So this patient with a lesion in prefrontal cortex are unable to adapt, to shift to the new rule. And interestingly enough, according to Sansan and Albert, there's a concept called stuck instead perseveration associated with lesion in dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex. This is here. And these patients are unable to adapt to changes. And now, if you remember the fixation errors here, type 1, type 2, type 3, and if you look at patients with a dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex lesion, like Parkinsonian, for instance, the first type is abulia. Abulia means inability for decision-making, lack of motivation. If you ask this patient to draw a circle, they will draw a circle. If you ask them to draw a square, they will keep on drawing a circle. And then they exhibit lack of mental flexibility when they perform this test, for instance. And you see that it looks like healthy subjects, but in a stressing situation, facing fatigue, stress, emotion. So to convince you, there are also evidences and the key role played by dopamine. When you have patients with Parkinson, if you want to cure them, you can give them injection of dopamine, especially in the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, and it is really efficient to cure them from perseveration. And so they use a model with macaque, with monkeys, that they had first brain lesion in dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, and then if you do injection of dopamine, they are able to perform this task, the A not B. So what is A not B task? Very simple task. Yes, so this is a game for kids. So there is an object here, you hide it. There's a curtain, but you change the position of the object. Usually the young kids, they persevere on trying to find the object here as it was in the first time. They're unable to adapt to the new rules. So with the monkeys, with the lesion, brain lesion in dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, they are not able to perform this task. But if you inject dopamine, they will be able to again perform the task in the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex. So let's go now to neuroergonomics. And so this is the study we are conducted with healthy subjects. So subjects facing fatigue, stress, emotion, excessive task demand. And interestingly enough, it led to deactivation of dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex and poor performance. I don't know if you're familiar with the RTMS. The idea is to stimulate or inhibit a part of the brain using magnetic stimulation. And depending if you inhibit the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, the healthy patient will have a risky behavior and a trend to persist in erroneous decision. But if you stimulate the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex, they will have a more rational, they will adapt to changes. We did a test, an experiment with my colleague, Michael Kors. So we asked first pilots to perform the Wisconsin sorting card test, which assess mental flexibility. Okay. So then we had the score, like numbers of error, numbers of perseverative error, and then the pilots have to fly a scenario in a flight simulator. And there was a strong correlation between number of perseverative error and the tendency to persist in an erroneous decision, learning decision. Unfortunately, we are all aware that aging impaired this executive functioning. Some colleagues of us at Stanford University, they did an experiment with other pilots that are more likely to persist in erroneous decision making. And ISAE also tried to give some dopamine to all pilots, okay? And so he reversed the trend, and this old pilot with dopamine were flying like young kids, okay? So maybe you will, the thing is that this dopamine lets you throw out, so don't use that in the cockpit. So again, you have brain lesion, brain atrophy due to normal aging, RTMS, emotion, fatigue, time on task, cognitive fatigue, task on time on task, task demand, low versus high. In all these studies, they were associated with a deactivation of the dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex. So why, what is the relationship between dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex and perseveration? One first explanation is that dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex is supposed to be, according to several authors, to be the neural correlates, one of the neural correlates of working memory. So working memory, you know, it involves updatability. So if you have an impairment here, you're unable to update your situation awareness so you're unable to adapt to the situation, so there you persist. The second hypothesis is that dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex is also the neural correlates of the supervisory attentional system. So it leads to inability to inhibit your response. So you keep on doing the same response. You're unable to adapt because you're unable to inhibit it. So Donoso and Kirkland did some nice study recently published in Science. So the key role of dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex in planning and adaptation, especially to create new strategy. So if you have an impairment here, you're unable to create new strategy. So thus you're forced to persist in the initial strategy because you have lost the ability to create a new policy. And as I told you, dorsal lateral prefrontal cortex play a key role to assess situation, to risk assessment. So if you lose this ability, you're not aware about risk, so then you're more likely to persist in erroneous decision making. So I'd like to get back to aviation now and to some of our studies. So we did this study some times ago. They're really interested in landing because landing is a very short flight phase, like 5% of the time for the whole flight, but it concentrates 51% of accidents. It's like 100% human error perseveration. We are all aware that landing is a rational decision. You have to supervise parameters, and if the parameters are not okay, you have to perform a go around. So it's like a go-no-go, highly rational task. But we know that emotional bias, like extra fuel consumption, passenger pressure, etc., may lead pilots to land instead of performing a go around. So here is the operational situation. The pilot is supposed to supervise these parameters. And basic go-no-go tasks, the pilot is supposed to push the lever if you don't want to land and want to perform the go-around. So we place some pilots in fMRI, and with a push button, and we presented a simplified version of these parameters. So in order to induce stress, to reproduce an ecological setting, we manipulated the level of uncertainty and incentive. In one condition, there were no money, no incentive. In the other condition, pilots were paid €5, or let's say $5, to perform the landing. If they perform a go-around, good decision to go around, there were $2 penalty. Okay, even if it was the good decision, we wanted to associate the go-around with punishment, because in real life, you know, you lose time, it costs a lot of money. And there were penalty for $5 for erroneous go-around decision. So what we observed, we had a lot of results. Of course, when the pilots had no money, it was safety first. But as soon as in the incentive condition, pilots were exhibited more risky behavior. And as you can see in this slide, this is the quality of the decision. Here we have on the x-axis good decision maker, and here a risky decision maker. And on the y-axis, the level of activation of the famous dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, or this, also this region that is involved in conflict solving. And you see that good decision maker have a high activation of dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, whereas risky decision maker are deactivation of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. Another study that we conducted using FNIRS, not going to go into detail, but we want to investigate mental overload. Some study using fMRI, very basic task, demonstrated deactivation associated with mental overload. We wanted to do it in a more ecological way and using FNIRS instead of fMRI. So basically, the participant was supposed to fly this aircraft according to a cue. So we're not supposed to fly the yellow one, but the green plane. We manipulated, it was like an N-back task, so there was N-back 1, N-back 2, and two level of flying difficulty. So what you have to keep in mind is that it was from very easy to barely impossible to perform. So this is the FNIR, and especially on the left dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. When it was easy, getting more hard, you see an increase in dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, and then when it was becoming overloaded, we found a kind of lower activation of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. So in fact, pilot was persisting in flying the wrong aircraft. We also measure heart rate variability. We observe exactly the same pattern. And it's well admitted that there are some strong connection between prefrontal cortex and cardiac activity and regulation of heart rate variability. So now it's time to find solutions. So we're facing a kind of paradox, guys. So how can we expect to cure pilot from perseveration if they neglect any warning, any visual signal, any auditory warning? So maybe a key against its neuroergonomics to step into the post-neural model of attention. This is a very ancient one, very simplified. But if I look at you on the left, that I look at you, Sebastian, first, I have to disengage, then shift my attention, then re-engage it. Interestingly enough, there's been some study with patients with abrasion in the thalamus here in the pulvinar. If I show them my hand, they will glance and they will focus on my hand. And if I show my other hand, they will be still focus on my left hand. Okay? They did that with monkeys again, with a lesion, focal lesion on pulvinar. With monkeys, you can show them objects. Then banana juice, they will not be able to change their focus and to consider the banana juice. Interestingly enough, a study conducted by Tracy placed some healthy subjects like you and I in fMRI, but with very stressing condition with surrounding sounds, very aggressive sounds, performing an attentional task, and the participants were unable to change their focus, and it was associated with the deactivation of this triangular network of attention. So again, between healthy subject, the stress, and patient, there are some kind of correlation in terms of behavior. So what we propose is, instead of adding information, we propose to remove information and to replace the accurate message in the visual field. So the rationale behind it is that user interface disengage, then reshift the pilot's attentional focus. So it was the participant was supposed to control a UAV to teleoperate unmanned ground vehicle and to identify a target. But when they were particularly engaged, focused on identifying the target, there was a battery failure. So the robot wanted to go back to base. And there are three displays. So here it's green, it's red, low battery. The mode turned to supervise, and the robot say, I'm going back to base. But 8 out of 11 participants were so focused on identifying the target that they didn't notice this different warning. So what we did is just simply remove for 1 second the display, and you see that immediately the patient, the subject, okay, will glance just by removing this information, like 600 milliseconds, you will reorient the attention. And it worked with mostly all of our participants. And now you see that they're glancing all the user interface. Another solution that's proposed by my colleague Michael Kos, you probably please see if you want to hear more the poster with Emily. So the idea is to show what to do using the property of the mirror neuron. Okay, so you know when you have an alarm, you have to hear it, you have to pay attention to it, you have to trust the alarm, you have to process the meaning, and you have to perform the correct action. So it takes a lot of time. And for pull-up alarms, like avoiding the terrain, it can lead to 7, 8, 9 seconds. This is too late. So my colleague proposed just to display a hand pulling the stick in order to activate the neural the motor cortex. And we found that with the classical alarm, we had like a 7 second response time. With the action, when you display the action, you divide by 3 the reaction time. So it seems to be a very efficient method. And my colleague Michael Kos, with his PhD student, is doing some very interesting EEG stuff. And just I would like to end this presentation with one work we did. I was lucky enough to have a cooperation with Hasan Ayaz. And the idea is to monitor working memory in real pilot's working memory in real time. So as I'm running right out of time, so the idea is, you know, pilot is to interact with ATC, air traffic controller, and we're all aware that working memory is limited. So we'd like to see if we can detect this kind of limitation. But first, we'd like to design a brain-computer interface to monitor, to do single-trial working memory load identification in ecological condition and online. So we did, in a neuroergonomics fashion, the first study involving a digit span, and you see that if the digit span, the size of the digit span increased, that you have more, you have a higher increase of the prefrontal cortex, and nicely you see dorsolateral, left and right dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, like fMRI study. But what we want to do is to make it in a more ecological way. So pilots were hearing air traffic controller instruction. We have a low level, so very easy task. Please, Sebastian.
Superior 32, speed 150, heading 150, altitude 1,500, vertical speed plus 1,500, over.
Thank you. So that was quite easy. Yeah, I see. And now for the difficult one, please try to read back the instruction. Carol, I know you work on this topic, so please.
Superior 32, speed 256, heading 138, altitude 12,400, vertical speed plus 1,500, over.
So I know there are some pilots in the room, so if you can read back the instruction. Okay, so it was, yeah, quite difficult. And then after that, the pilot was supposed to dial the speed here with a knob, heading, altitude, etc., etc. So there was 2 extreme conditions. We designed a BCI. Sebastian, can you show the contrast? So this is offline analysis, the contrast high versus low.
Superior 32, speed 256, heading 138, altitude 12,400, vertical speed plus 1,500, over.
So the pilot is dialing the instruction, and you see first right dorsolateral prefrontal cortex activation. And you see that this is the difficult task, and it will also recruit left parts of the prefrontal cortex. And so this led us to good classification accuracy, means that in 80% of the time we were able to classify a low load versus a high load and compare favorably to other nice studies. Then the new challenge was to conduct this experiment in real flight condition. So we had 12 VFR pilots, and we use a Hasan mini wireless mini snare device. So we had all the clearance from the EASA to conduct this experiment with a safety pilot. And here are the pilots with the FNIRs. So the first interesting thing that we found, we compared between flight versus flight real flight versus simulator, and in real flight condition, as expected, they had more errors. If you look at prefrontal cortex activation, you see that consistently with this finding, there are more activation on the prefrontal cortex, especially in the hot condition when they were flying. And this last result, we had a nice accuracy to detect online in real flight condition, low versus high. This is a good result because when you're flying the aircraft, they were supposed really to fly to supervise, monitor the environment, interact with different things. So we're happy that even in real operational condition, we can identify working memory load activation. So thank you very much.